So good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Oftech for the invitation to our ophthalmology department to present our experience with Artiflex Toric phakic IOL in the next few minutes. So I will share with you our experience. So it is well known that intraocular surgery is usually needed to treat high magnitude myopia. There is a good phakic IOL implantation in young patients is an appealing surgery due to the fact that it's a reversible refractive procedure, and it allows to preserve accommodation. So in people younger than 45 years of age, usually the procedures of choice when approaching a high magnitude myopia. So there's a lot of evidence nowadays demonstrating the efficacy, stability and predictability of the toric Artiflex in correcting myopia and astigmatism. So we will talk a little bit of our experience. It is well known already the anatomic criteria that the patient had to have before the implantation to have some safety features like the anatomy of the anterior chamber and the endothelium distance from the endothelium to the natural lens not to be inferior to 3 millimeters. One critical distance is the distance between the edge of the lens to the endothelium, which is advised to be superior to 1.5 millimeters. We all know that we have to have a safety endothelium profile with a number of cells usually superior to 1,000 by square millimeters. We always have to consider also the shape of the iris and try to avoid a convex iris that is most important in case of hyperopia. Regarding pupil size, we know that mesopic pupil should be inferior to 7 millimeters. So the Artiflex Toric is a 3-piece IOL with 2 PMMA haptics and a foldable silicone optical zone which allows us to enter in with a 3.2 millimeter incision which is sutureless free. There's no model available for hyperopia, and one size fits all. So this was our inclusion criteria and the data that we collect from our retrospective analysis. So we have 34 eyes implanted with toric Artiflex IOL with a mean age of 35 years, and with a follow-up time, a medium follow-up time of 19 months. The mean refractive cylinder pre-surgery was -8.26, and the cylinder -2.33. So when comparing best corrected visual acuity pre-operatively with the uncorrected visual acuity after surgery, we noticed that there was not a statistical significant difference, which was an unexpected result and demonstrates the safety of the procedure. This graphic demonstrates the mean refractive sphere and the mean refractive cylinder, always between half dioptera and the standard deviation. When considering a vectorial analysis of the total refractive error with this spherical component and the cylinder components, the two vectorial components of the astigmatism, we have after surgery we can see that there is a much more aggregation around the origin of zero, which is also visualized here. When we consider only the astigmatism, the two vectorials that define the astigmatism, the blue ones, which are the post-surgical one, which is very condensed in the origin. So we also calculate the success index that usually the perfect or that the intended one is to be one, and we have an sphere index of success of 0.98, very close to one, and astigmatism a little bit shorter. So about the percentage of patients that were in the between with a sphere between half diopter, we have 94% of the eyes, and with a cylinder we have 76% of the eyes. 17% of the eyes experience an improvement of best correct visual acuity over the pre-op. Overall, we achieve a high success percentage of spectacle independence. Only one patient needed to use spectacle in more demanding tasks. Regarding uncorrected visual acuity, the percentage of eyes that achieved a visual acuity superior to 5/10 was 97%, and the percentage of people of patients achieving a visual acuity superior to 9/10 was 76%. There was no case of best corrected visual acuity loss, and only 15% of the patient had some degree of phakic phenomenon. Regarding reintervention, one patient had to be reintervention due to haptic subluxation. Regarding post-operative alignment, we observed that the absolute misalignment was the mean was about 5 degrees. So, when analyzing the endothelial cells, we only performed this analysis at the follow-up time, and we observed a mean decrease that was statistically significant, about 3.5% of the mean cellular count, but we cannot infer about the chronology of this loss, because this is only data reporting to the follow-up time of 19 months. So our results demonstrate that the phakic IOL, the toric Artiflex, is a good option treating high myopia refractive errors and with a good safety profile, and that despite residual refractive error, the myopic patient tend to be very pleased with the final outcome and independent of spectacles. Thank you, and that's all.